प्रीवियसली वी हैव डिस्कस्ड,
हेलो
या हेलो, ओके। प्रीवियसली वी हैव डिस्कस्ड सेवरल मेजरमेंट्स। इन दिस सेकेंड यूनिट वी हैड सम ऑफ द टॉपिक्स विच आर लेफ्ट देयर एंड सम ऑफ देम विच वी ऑलरेडी डिस्कस्ड इन दिस टॉपिक अंडर मेजरमेंट्स एंड टेस्टिंग वॉज फ्यूल मेजरमेंट। ओके, प्रीवियसली वी हैव ऑलरेडी डिस्कस दैट। टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस एयर इनटेक, दैट मीन्स एयर कंजम्पशन। ओके, इंडिकेटेड पावर मेजरमेंट ऑफ सिलेंडर प्रेशर वी हैव ऑलरेडी डन एंड दिस आर द सेवरल फैक्टर्स विच वी हैव ऑलरेडी डिस्कस्ड। ओके, नाउ वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस मेथड्स टू मेजर एयर। वी हैव ऑलरेडी डन और गॉन थ्रू ऑल ऑफ दिस। So now I am going to discuss how to measure air consumption or air intake. First of all, there will be two basic methods in this. One is air box method and the viscous flow air meter. And in this air box method and viscous flow air meter, the accurate one is the second one, which is viscous flow air meter. Why? Because here there is no any filtering device or any such particular device. That means here throughout the engine operation there will be some pulsation. That means air intake is not going to be at same level at different times regarding the speed of the engine. Okay, the air intake for the engine is going to vary. So because of that pulsation, it is not that much easy to calculate the measurement of air intake. So that's why what we are doing, first of all, we are using two methods and this is the accurate one, and one by one we will discuss now. Coming to air box method, in this air box method we are going to take an air tank. Why we are going to, and the volume of this air tank should be 500 to 600 times of the swept volume. Whatever the engine we have taken, there will be certain cylinder, and within the cylinder we are going to have particular swept volume. Already we know what is swept volume, clearance volume, total volume. So to that swept volume, we have to take the volume of air tank. Whatever the air tank we had taken, that should have 500 to 600 times. Why we need to take that much volume of air tank? Why? Because the pulsations during the engine operations are going to be very high. So to minimize those pulsations, that means to damp those pulsation, we are going to take the volume, an air tank of volume 500 to 600 times than when compared to the swept volume of the engine which we has taken. Okay, to damp the vibration, that means to damp the pulsations. Okay, so that's why we are going to take air tank of much higher volume. And the pressure difference, there will be a manometer which is going to be connected with this air tank, and the pressure difference is going to be shown here within the manometer. Okay, first of all, the air tank is going to show some pressure, and after the intake, from intake the engine is going to consume some air and there will be some pressure difference. So the pressure difference before consumption and after consumption will give us how much amount of air is going to be consumed by the engine with the help of this manometer. Nothing but this manometer will show us the pressure difference before consumption and after consumption of air. And this, there will be an orifice plate here. This orifice plate will show us how much amount of or how much volume of air is going to be in this air tank. Okay, so we can calculate easily by the help of pressure difference here. This is a delta H. That means it is pressure difference is going to be shown in the manometer in terms of delta H. So that means change in height. There will be some fluid within this manometer. And there will be some changes. Then some height changes here. And by there will be several formulas to calculate the pressure difference here. And by knowing pressure difference, we can easily calculate the air consumption. That is one method. And next one is viscous flow air meter. This is the accurate method. Why? Because here there will be triangular shaped matrix is going to be there. Here it was not shown in a triangular shape, but this is the matrix which is going to be a triangular shaped matrix are going to be there. okay, triangle, small triangular cases are going to be there, like honeycomb structure. Okay, so this will help, and the whatever the dimensions are going to be like this, 75 mm into 7 mm into 0.5 mm height. That means 75 into 7 into 0.5 mm. These are the dimensions of this particular matrix. Okay, and there will be air filter. Why we need to use air filter? Why? Because here, whenever air passing through this matrix, there will be some impurities or dust particles within the air. So what we need to do, we need to eliminate those. So that's why we are going to keep air filter here. That means whatever the dust particles or some oily particles within the air are going to be there, those are going to be filtered here. After filtration, the air, whatever the pure air is going to be there, that pure air is going to be sent to the, or it is the pure air is sent to this matrix, which is going to damp the vibrations. Here the main thing is to minimize the pulsation. That is the main thing which we need to do. And here we have used the air tank, but here we are using the matrix here. Okay, so okay, so what we are going to do here with the help of this matrix, we are going to damp the pulsation. After minimizing the pulsation, we are going to send that air directly to the engine. And similarly here, we have manometer. Similarly, within this also, we are going to have manometer here. So by having air filter and this matrix along with this manometer, the pressure difference itself is going to show us the air consumption here. Okay, the measurement, type of measurement is similar in both the cases, but here we are going to take extra precautions. More number of precautions are going to be taken. That's why it is going to be accurate when compared to the air box method. So in this way, we are going to measure the air consumption within the engine or air intake for the engine. And these are the two methods which we have discussed now. Okay, next coming to measurement of speed. Okay, actually, how can we measure the speed in terms of kilometers per hour? Okay, in kmph, right? So in vehicles, generally in vehicles, it is going to be there will be several factors which are going to say the speed here. Okay, first of all, we need to compute power, and also it is going to depend upon the design, and also the several developments are going to be there within the design. So according to that, first of all, there are several devices which can measure the speed of the vehicle, like mechanical counters, tachometers, stroboscope, electric counters, tachometer, electric pulse counter. These are several devices which can measure the speed in different notations. First, suppose if we take tachometers, it is going to give us in RPM. Then after taking that value, we need to convert that into kmph, kilometers per hour. Okay, so instead of doing all those, the best method of measuring speed is to count the number of revolutions in a given time. First, suppose if we have 1 second time, and within that 1 second time, how many number of revolutions are going to be taken by that wheel? Okay, so that gives us the accurate measurement of speed. And how can we count the number of revolutions? There are several devices like electric counter, like or a mechanical counter, or a pickup is going to be there. Magnetic pickup is going to be there. First, suppose if we take a wheel, for every revolution of that wheel, okay, for every revolution of that wheel, there will be a magnetic pickup. Okay, it will there be within this magnetic pickup a pulse counter is going to be placed. That means for every revolution of wheel, it will give one pulse. If we take a wheel, it is going to rotate. Whenever it is going to rotate, for every revolution, it is the pulse is going to be generated. So along with that, a pulse counter is there. So there are number of revolutions are going to be two, means two times it is going to generate pulse here, and there will be automatically a pulse counter is going to be there. Okay, this pulse counter will note down the number of pulses. Okay, how pulse is going to be generated depending upon the revolution. If the wheel is going to take one revolution, it is going to generate one pulse. If the wheel is going to take two revolutions, it will generate second pulse. If the wheel is going to take the third revolution, then again there is a pulse generation. So for every revolution, there is one pulse generation, and these pulses are going to be counted by a pulse counter. That means there will be a counter which can record every pulse. Okay, so in that way we are going to use the pulse counter, and with the help of that we can note down how many pulse are going to be there, pulse are going to be generated. So with the help of pulse counter, how many pulses they are generated, that number is given to us, and per specific time. For suppose a pickup meter, magnetic pickup is placed near tooth wheel, it is going to give some 50 pulses. Okay, 50 pulses per second. Now we are going to, already we know the diameter of the wheel. So for every pulse, how much distance it is going to travel. Okay, so these pulses are going to be converted into kilometers. The time is going to be the same. So depending on that, by knowing the diameter of the wheel, we can automatically know the number of kilometers it has traveled. Okay, so here how much speed it is going to be kilometer per hour. So per hour, how much kilometers is going to be traveled can be given by the magnetic pickup pulse counter. Okay, so that is how we are going to measure speed here. Of course, it is not that much important. Measurement of air intake, measurement of fuel, measurement of cylinder pressure, till now which we have discussed, are very much important. Okay, the methods within those are also very important. Next, coming to measurement of exhaust gas composition. Okay, so in exhaust gas composition, first of all, what is exhaust gas? Okay, here exhaust means after the utilization of power, first of all there will be fuel air mixture, and after burning, after combustion, there will be some power developed, and after developing the power, there will be some residual gases which are left over, and those residual gases are nothing but the exhaust gases. Those exhaust gases are going to come out from the silencer here. Okay, so these are the exhaust gases, and what are the elements which are going to be there within the exhaust gas? There are a lot of elements. Like, so these are the some of the elements which are going to be there within the exhaust gas, like carbon dioxide, water vapor, oxides of nitrogen, unburnt hydrocarbons, carbon monoxide, aldehyde, smoke, and particulates. So out of these eight, these are the major things, and these are the principal elements which are going to be in the exhaust gas. Okay, so out of eight, first six are going to be invisible, we can't see them, but the seventh and eighth, which we can call them as visible emissions. Okay, so first six are going to be invisible emissions, and last two are going to be the visible emissions. Okay, so first of all, coming to carbon dioxide and water vapor, we are not going to measure them. Why we are not going to measure them? Why? Because the carbon dioxide and water vapor doesn't cause any harm to the environment. So whatever the things or whatever the elements are going to be there within the exhaust gas, regarding these two, except these two, all others are going to create some damage to the environment. So that's why what we need to do, we need to measure them. How much oxides of nitrogen are going to be there, how much unburnt hydrocarbons are going to be there, how much carbon monoxide is going to be coming, how much aldehydes are there in the exhaust. So we need to measure all of them. Okay, how can we measure? There are several methods to measure. Okay, we will discuss later. And coming to all these eight things, first two are not going to be measured. Why? Because they are not going to cause harm. And why we need to study all the others, and or why we need to measure all the others? Why? Because we need to minimize the emissions. Whatever the oxides of nitrogen, unburned hydrocarbons, carbon monoxide, aldehyde, smoke, and particulate are there. These are going to harm the environment. So what we need to do? We need to definitely minimize them. Okay, if the quantity of or the amount of our nitrogen oxides or unburnt hydrocarbons are going to high, it will definitely damage the environment. So we need to know the how much amount of all these gases are going to evolve, and if these are not going to be under the norms, if they are going to be above the norms, there will be certain norms here, like pollution control norms, BS1, BS2, nothing but these are pollution control norms here. Recently, Indian government has implemented BS6. Okay, that means nothing but here the vehicle is going to be allowed in our country only if it is going to follow BS6 norms. Here, BS6 norms means these exhaust gases should be very, very low. Then only that vehicle has permission to run on the Indian roads. Okay, so that's why previously we have followed BS4. That means some amount of carbon monoxide and nitrogen oxides or hydrocarbons are going to be they are acceptable to some extent, but nowadays these should be very, very less. Otherwise, the government itself is not giving permission to run on Indian roads. So that's why this much importance is given to exhaust gas composition. So, and how we are going to measure all this? I already said these two need not be measured. Why? Because here these two are not going to harm the environment. So that's why we are going to talk about all these exhaust gas components. Okay, so that is the main thing here. So these are the methods, electronic temperature sensitive transducers. That means these are the some of the equipment to measure exhaust gas composition. Okay, here this is measuring exhaust gas temperature by using thermocouple. We need to know the temperature also if you want to know. Okay, this is about emissions here. Next, coming to oxides of nitrogen. First of all, I already said these two are not going to be determined by or measured. Why? Because these two doesn't harm the environment. So first of all, we are going to determine the oxides of nitrogen here. Okay, see here how to measure oxides of nitrogen and why we need to measure the oxides of nitrogen, and what is the importance of oxides of nitrogen, and where the oxides of nitrogen in the operating conditions of engine are going to be high. Okay, so first of all, we need to know where these oxides of nitrogen are going to be high. Okay, whenever the temperature, okay, at the normal temperatures, the nitrogen oxides are not going to be there. Why? Because the at a normal temperatures, whenever the CO, what is chemical reaction here? Hydrocarbons mix with air, that means oxygen. Whenever these hydrocarbons mix with oxygen, we are going to get carbon monoxide and all this. So we already know the chemical reaction. Okay, so whenever these oxides of nitrogen are going to evolve, what happens here? There are several damages caused to the environment. So we need to minimize them. First of all, to minimize means, first of all, we need to know how much amount of oxides are going to be there, right? So here, this is a particular device which is called as chemiluminescence method of measuring oxides of nitrogen. See here, there will be air, whatever the exhaust gas is there, that is going to taken into all these tubes. Okay, this is the flow meter here, and spam gas in, that means we are going to send some gas. What that means, whatever the exhaust gas is there, that exhaust gas we are going to take into it, and here air we are going to send. Not only air, along with that air, we are going to have ozone generator here. Okay, before going to know the nitrogen measurement, we need to know where these are going to be at high level, where nitrogen oxides of nitrogen are going to evolve more. That means at high temperatures, we are going to see most frequently. NOx emissions are going to be seen most effectively or most heavily at high temperatures. At normal temperatures, the reaction is going to be complete combustion. So much NOx, that means oxides of nitrogen are not going to be there. And also these NOx emissions, NOx, NOx means NOx emissions. Okay, these NOx emissions are going to be heavier to nearer stoichiometric ratios. Why? Because at high temperatures, these are going to combust rapidly. So because of that rapid reaction, these NOx are going to be high. Oxides of nitrogen are going to be high. If the mixture is too lean or too rich, these are not going to evaluate. That means these are not going to evolve here. Why? Because here the rate of reaction is somewhat less here, so that temperatures are also not that much good. Okay, basically where oxides of nitrogen are higher at high temperatures. So to have high temperatures means a complete reaction should be, a complete combustion at much faster rate should be taken place, then only high temperatures are going to evolve. If there is no much high temperature, then oxides of nitrogen are going to be less. Okay, so that's why a intensive care has to be taken while designing an engine. Okay, power is higher at near stoichiometric ratios, but if we take that, what is going to happen? Emissions are going to be there. Okay, once emissions are going to be there, that engine is not at all acceptable by the Indian government. So what we should do? So that's why we need to check all the parameters, and it is a critical thing in designing an engine. We need to see the emissions. At the same time, we need to give mileage. That means with the less amount, it should take some less amount of fuel. At the same time, the chemical reaction rate also should be high. It shouldn't be much higher. Why? Because these emissions are going to be there. So that's why an intensive care has to be taken while designing an engine. Okay, because of all these parameters. Okay, if there is one, while designing an engine, if there is one positive, there are several negatives are going to be there. Okay, so we need to see several times about the design of engine. Okay, that much critical situations has to be faced while designing an engine. So near stoichiometric ratios, these are going to be high, and at near stoichiometric ratios only the power output is going to be high. So what we need to do? So we need to design in between these two. It shouldn't be too much nearer the top dead center, the spark initiation. It should, that means there will be some spark advance is going to be there. Okay, and this spark advance should be optimum. That's why I said you in first class onwards, the optimum spark timing should be at optimum conditions. Okay, spark timing should be in optimum condition, and it shouldn't be too advanced. If it is too advanced also, these NOx emissions are going to be high. If this is too advanced, what happens? There may be no much much reaction rate is not going to be there. If there is no much reaction rate, incomplete combustion is going to be there. Incomplete combustion means nothing but oxides of nitrogen and carbon monoxides are going to be heavier. So that's what I am saying. We need to minimize them. Okay, so those are the things which we need to keep in mind while designing an engine. And that is what about oxides of nitrogen. Now we need to know how these oxides of nitrogen are going to be measured. Okay, first of all, in this chemiluminescence method of measuring oxides of nitrogen, we can measure only NO oxides. Okay, that means nitric oxide, only nitric oxide we can measure. Okay, after reaction we will get NO2 also. Okay, so what we need to do to measure NO2? Okay, to measure NO2, we need to send that into NOx or CO converter. Okay, why? Because here there will be some reaction chamber is going to be there. From here there will be NOx coming. That means only NO1, that means nitric oxide, is going to be here, and ozone from this ozone generator, ozone is going to be here. Okay, so if there is NO and O3, if there is reaction between NO and O3, then there is one light is going to be evaluated here because of reaction between NO and O3. Okay, the chemical reaction between NO and O3, there will be a light is going to be evaluated. Okay, so this depending upon the intensity of light, there will be a photomultiplier tube. Okay, this is going to take the record. That means it will record the intensity. Okay, so depending upon the intensity of this photomultiplier tube, we are going to know how much NO is going to be there. Okay, so definitely if there is in emissions, there will be both NO1 and NO2. Okay, but in this method, we can have direct access to NO and ozone only. Okay, NO, when NO and O3 reacts with each other, then only light is going to be emitted. So that depending upon the intensity of light, okay, that intensity of light will tell us how much NO is going to be there. Okay, and that is going to be recorded by this photomultiplier tube. Okay, but in exhaust gas, we are going to have both NO as well as NO2. So what we need to do, if there is any NO2, we need to separate it to NOx converter, and here NOx, that means NO2 is going to be converted to NO and again sent to this reaction chamber. Okay, so here we can measure only NO, and if there is NO2, what we need to do, we need to convert that NO2 into NO with the help of this NOx converter. Here it will convert NO2 to NO. Okay, then here within this reaction chamber, we will have only NO and O3. Okay, and because of reaction, chemical reaction between NO and O3, it is going to emit some light here. Okay, so whenever it is going to emit some light here, there will be some intensity for that particular light which is emitted, right? That intensity of light is going to be measured by this photomultiplier tube, so that depending upon number of amount of NO emissions, that much light intensity is going to be there. Okay, with the help of that, we are going to measure oxides of nitrogen with the help of this chemiluminescence method. Okay, in that way we are going to measure nitrogen oxides. Okay, clear? Next, coming to NDIR method of measuring carbon monoxide. Here NDIR means non-dispersive infrared reaction, okay, or infrared radiation. Okay, in this method we are going to measure carbon monoxide. Already I have discussed oxides of nitrogen, hydrocarbons and carbon monoxide. Okay, this unbound hydrocarbons we will see later, and this carbon monoxide we will see now, right? This carbon monoxide, there will be certain method here to know the carbon monoxide amount. That means within the exhaust gases, so much carbon monoxide is going to be there. That method we call as NDIR method, nothing but non-dispersive infrared radiation, okay, or infrared reaction. Depending on that, we are going to measure the carbon. That means this is one equipment which can measure carbon monoxide, right? Coming to this, first of all, there will be some receiver is going to be there. E1 is diaphragm, E2 is fixed counter electrode. There will be E3 is going to be there. Okay, this is the receiver trimmer, and F is the, this is the filter cell. Okay, and G is DC supply. Here is G. Okay, here we can see. Okay, there will be DC supply is going to be there, and M is the measuring cell. There will be two measuring cells, M1 and M2, and M1 which is the sample cell, and this is the reference cell. Okay, and R is the R is the resistance here. Okay, resistance. And S1, infrared sources, that means there will be some source to emit infrared rays, right? And S2 is the motor. This is the motor here, and S3 is shutter wheel. This is going to rotate throughout the measurement of carbon monoxide, and V8 is amplifier. There are two amplifiers here. One is V8 and one amplifier is going to be V8, and this is stabilization. V10 is the stabilization. Okay, and this is G, which is generate the DC supply. Okay, from here we are going to get the DC supply. Okay, so this is the measure, equipment which we need to discuss. Okay, in this carbon monoxide, how can we measure carbon monoxide? The main thing here is to measure carbon monoxide. This is the equipment we use, and there will be emitter here. Okay, through this emitter, whenever this carbon monoxide is going, there will be certain wavelength here. Okay, there will be some infrared rays here. Okay, for what this infrared rays will do means at particular wavelength. Okay, regarding that carbon monoxide. Okay, for carbon monoxide, it is a gas. Okay, at particular wavelength, this carbon monoxide is going to absorb here. Have you understood? See here, there for every gas there is particular wavelength, right? So for depending upon the wavelength, there will be particular wavelength for the carbon monoxide gas here. So at particular wavelength, this gas is going to be absorbed by this absorbing cell here. Okay, there will be wheel here, and there, this is M, which is measuring cell. That means within this we can measure how much amount of carbon is going to be there. Okay, so there will be emitter here. Okay, so at particular wavelength, okay, the infrared rays are going to absorb carbon monoxide gas, whatever the whole combustion exhaust gases are there. Within that, whatever the carbon monoxide is there, that is going to be absorbed here with the help of infrared rays. So at particular wavelength of carbon monoxide, with the help of infrared rays, these are going to absorb those carbon monoxide gas. Okay, so with the help of that absorption, we can measure how much amount of carbon monoxide is going to be there within this exhaust gases. Okay, in that way we are going to note down the carbon monoxide. Okay, so that is the way to measure the carbon monoxide. Simple thing, there will be infrared rays are going to be there. Okay, these infrared rays, what we will do, what they will do at particular wavelength, they are going to absorb. For every gas there is particular wavelength. For carbon monoxide gas also there will be certain wavelength. So at that wavelength, this infrared is going to absorb the carbon monoxide, right? So the depending upon the we already have measuring cell. With the help of measuring cell, we can know how much amount of carbon monoxide is absorbed the help of this NDIR equipment. Okay, in that way we are going to measure the carbon monoxide amount of carbon monoxide within the exhaust gases. Okay, and coming to this, where these are going to be higher and where these are going to be lesser, at most probably this carbon monoxide, where it is going to be there, when there is incomplete combustion, right? If there is incomplete combustion, that means at lean mixtures and too rich mixtures. Okay, if it is too lean or too rich, what happens? The carbon monoxide is going to be high. But coming to oxides of nitrogen, at too lean or too lean, these are low. Only at a stoichiometric, nearer stoichiometric ratios, these are going to be high. But this is vice versa here. Okay, this is vice versa here. Nearer stoichiometric ratios, the chemical reaction is going to be high. There will be more, what we can say, more reaction is going to be there. So there is no incomplete combustion. No incomplete combustion means nothing but there will be no much CO left. That means air or complete combustion means no incomplete combustion. That means no air or fuel is left within the cylinder. So there is no formation of carbon monoxide. So at too lean or too rich, at too lean mixture, what happens? Too lean mixture, there will be too lean means fuel is less, air is high. So some of the air is going to be there. That will lead to the incomplete combustion, where there is a chance of carbon monoxide. If the fuel which we have supplied is going to be too rich, okay, so there is no sufficient oxygen to burn with it. So incomplete combustion is going to be there, where there is evolution of CO there. Okay, that is main reasons for evolution of carbon monoxide within the engine. If the conditions are, if it is too rich or too lean. Okay, at a stoichiometric ratios or near stoichiometric ratios, there will be no carbon monoxide emissions. Mostly carbon dioxide is going to be there, right? So that is the way, and these are the cases where we can, where carbon monoxide is going to be higher and lower. At these cases, we can tell that the carbon monoxide is going to high and carbon monoxide is going to low. And this is the method. That means it uses infrared rays. Okay, by using infrared rays, it is going to absorb that particular wavelength of carbon monoxide gas. Okay, by absorbing that, we